If you're going to be working with databases, it is highly likely you'll be using some sort of structured query language or SQL, SQL. While there are variants of SQL, they all follow the same basic rules and definitions. In this video, you'll learn what SQL is and how it works with relational databases. We'll go through some use cases and investigate what a table is and what a SQL statement is, along with the basic syntax. If you're wanting to start using SQL with databases, you've come to the right place. SQL is a strongly typed declarative language. This means it's easier to get it right as the syntax is more stringent and you only declare what you want instead of having to program it yourself. For example, you use SQL to define what parts of a dataset you want, not how you get it. All right, let me show you. So talking about declarative language, let me just show you a really quick example here. So I'm in SQL Server Management Studio, and I'm looking at the AdventureWorks database, and I'll talk more about that later in this episode as well. I'm gonna click on new query here. And I'm just going to copy paste a bit of SQL so you can don't have to watch me type. So here we have a select statement, and I'm just saying I want the title, first name, and last name from the table called person.person, where the first name is Mary. I am not programming anything, I'm just declaring what I would like. So when I execute this, I am getting all of the records that has a first name with Mary. Behind the scenes, there's a bunch of code that takes my declarative statement and obviously interprets it so that the database can understand it. But that's all that declarative is. It's very easy to approach and it's very easy to learn because it kind of makes sense from the start because you're just declaring what you need. A relational database management system, or RDBMS, is the system that your SQL statement talks to, which then returns the data requested from the database. Microsoft SQL, Oracle Database, and MySQL are all examples of RDBMS implementations that you could use SQL with. Now we know what SQL is and where it lives. What can you do with it then? SQL allows you to retrieve, insert, and update data in a database, given you have the right permissions. You can create regular reports from the data, you can automate tasks that manipulate the data and schema, and you can update data based on rules and other triggers. SQL is easy to learn, easy to start using, and easy to create very powerful data operations with. It is a language that keeps on giving as you learn about the intricacies and details of it. Let's get into the more tangible aspects of SQL and how it works. In order for us to work with any kind of data, that data has to be in a table. A table is a defined part of the entire dataset being stored in the database. A table consists of columns, which each account for a single piece of data within a row. For example, you can have a database called Online Store DB. Inside that database are a number of tables, one of which is customer. You might have guessed that it holds customer data. Each row in the customer table represents a customer record. The record is split up into multiple columns, such as user ID, customer num, first name, last name, and email address. A SQL statement is then used to get that data out of, insert data into, and update data in that customer table. And that brings us to the syntax of SQL statements. Let me show you how it all works by using a practical example. Now, if you want to join in, I'm using SQL Server, the AdventureWorks database, and SQL Server Management Studio to type my queries into. They're all free and linked in the resources. So I'm back in SQL Server Management Studio where we left off just a little bit ago in the episode. And I've got my statement here from before. So this is the select statement. So select means I just want to view data. I want to get data out, not manipulate it in any way. I just want to look at the data that matches my declarative statement here. So that's the select. In this particular case, I'm selecting three columns, title, first name, and last name from, so that's the table, from the table person.person. And then there's a condition, which is where is the conditional, first name equal Mary. So that's the select statement and the syntax for that. Now, if I want to update a record, I'm just going to copy paste this again so you don't have to watch me type. Here's an update statement. So if I were to run this, which I will in just a second, I'm going to update the table person.person, and I'm going to set the first name of a record to Lars, and I'm going to give it a condition on what to update. Now, this is critical. Don't ever have an update statement without a where statement, because if I took out the where statement in this case, I would update every single record in the person.person database, table rather, to have first name equal Lars. The where here is super important, as it is with the delete statement, which we'll get to in just a minute. So if I run this, execute this statement rather, there we go, one row affected. That's good. You want to see one row affected ideally, or just a very small number, right? Otherwise, you know something's wrong. Then I can, in SQL Server Management Studio, I can right-click person.person, and I'm just going to look at the top 1,000 rows. Just so we can see here, you can see down here, the row with business entity ID 1 has been updated to first name equal Lars. So I just go back here. So that's an update statement, right? You're updating a record, one or more records, as few as you can get away with. You've got to be very specific with your update statements. So in that vein, let's have a look at the delete statement. Looks like this, delete from person.person. Again, there must be a where statement. There must be a conditional, otherwise you would delete the entire table, right? So where business identity ID is equal to 1. So this is obviously just going to delete it. I could also say where first name is Lars or whatever, but be as specific as you can. And ID is always good because you know you're targeting a single row. So I'm going to click execute. Oh, we have a constraint here. So this is a good thing. You can see here that there is a foreign key. FK is foreign key. That means another table is dependent on this row, so I can't delete it. Now, this is really good because it's a safeguard that says, hey, you can't delete a row that another row in another table is dependent on. So you can see here that now SQL Server saved me from making a mess of it. But that's the delete statement, and this is how it would look. Now, if I wanted to delete this particular row, I would have to go and first delete all of the other rows in other tables that are referencing this particular person. So I hope that makes sense. But that's a delete statement. And then finally, we're going to have an insert statement. Like so, and you can see this is one of the more verbose commands, because I'm saying insert into and then a table, and then I have to define every single field or column that I want to insert data into. So we have business entity ID, person type, name style, title, first name, last name, email promotion, row good, and modified date. Now you might be wondering, why didn't I choose all of the columns? Because this is not all of the ones that are in this particular table. You can see here, if I expand person.person in the columns, some of these fields have a null. That means that you are allowed to insert nothing. A null value is nothing. That means I don't have to define them when I do an insert statement. All the others that say not null, I do. In this case, I've defined a business entity ID. That's the next one in incremental order for this particular row. I have a person type, guessing that's employee, I'm not sure. Name style is 0, whatever that is. I need to give it a title, Lord, because I always wanted to be a Lord, why not? First name, last name. Then we have the 0, which is the email promotion, so that's saying I don't want an email promotion. And then there needs a row GUID. So that's a unique identifier for the row, and you can just have this. This is a function in SQL, new ID. That will return a GUID, and the same with current timestamp is a function that will return a date timestamp. So I can use that. So if I run that, you can see I get an error. Again, these are good. We want to keep the errors because we learn from those. The business entity ID, I can't actually define that because it's a primary key that has a foreign key constraint. You can see here the foreign key, person, business entity ID, is depending on it. And you can see the config occurred in table person business entity. So I can't actually use that. So in this case, I would have to go to the table, which is defined near the end, person.business entity, and insert in a row that would then match this particular value 2778. So this is part of the safety net, I guess, with SQL, is that you set up these foreign keys and primary keys so that you don't get into trouble. That is the basic syntax of the commands select, update, delete, and insert in SQL. And now back to, well, me. SQL queries is a very approachable way to select, update, delete, and sort data from any dataset. This episode showed you what SQL is, how it relates to an RDBMS, what you can use SQL for, and finally, how to use it in a variety of statements such as select, update, delete, insert, and where. Of course, there's a lot more to SQL queries, but you can find that information on the A-Cloud Guru platform. If you enjoyed this video, give it a thumbs up and consider subscribing to the channel for everything cloud computing. Keep being awesome, cloud gurus.